Due to the fact that this is a formal congregation of a graduation ceremony, there's a few legislative practices that I will go through with you. The first being that we have to formally open the proceedings by the highest academic body. And so we ask Senate representatives who have the power vested in them to open it, to open the ceremony. And today we're indeed delighted to have one of our senior Senate members, Ezra Ndwande, who is joined by me on my left-hand side. Sorry, Ezra. And then next to him is our council representative, which is Zane Redier. And alongside Zane is Louise Fuller, who is the registrar of the Institute, who will be capping students. And my name is Dr. Marla Koonen. I am the Executive Dean of Strategy and Stakeholder Management here at the Institute, and I will be your program director for today. I would also like to just mention two other guests that are here with us today. We are indeed privileged to have our keynote speaker, who has risen very early in America, Dr. Mary Ritz, who is joining us via Zoom. Mary, we're looking very forward to having our discussion with you later, and we thank you for waking up very early to join us. Thank you, Dr. Ritz. And then we also have from Metro Mines, Janine Wells, who's our industry representative, who is here today to also congratulate the students. So without further ado, I ask our Senate representative, Ezra Ndwande, to please open this procession as a legal gathering. Ezra?
By the power vested in me as a member of the Davinci Institute Senate, I hereby constitute this congregation as a lawful gathering for the Davinci Institute.
It is indeed a privilege for me to be able to do the introduction this morning. So I say, Honourable Senate Member, our Council Member, distinguished guests from industry, the community, our guest speaker, Dr. Ritz, faculty, family and friends, both here and now due to our new world order online as well. We welcome everybody here and of course to our most distinguished guests, our remarkable 2020 graduates, all protocols observed. I say to you today, greetings, Khruta, Lochani, Molo, Saubona, Dumela Avucheni, and welcome to this momentous occasion, the day that you have received rite of passage to gain your qualification. Your graduation, as I've said earlier, is currently live streaming to YouTube. We do put it on Facebook, Instagram, LinkedIn, etc. But we love it when you share your own personal posts and you tag us in those posts. So please share any memories you have or any celebrations you have with your graduation by tagging the Davinci Institute in those. I found a really beautiful sort of analogy, and I thought it was really quite special. They speak about the fact that in Japan, broken objects are often repaired with gold. The floor is seen as a unique piece of the object's history, which just adds to its beauty. Consider this whenever you feel broken or defeated, or you feel like you just need a change. I thought this uniqueness of individuals and remarkability was really something quite profound, because when something is broken, as we all are as individuals in some way, we often think that it is damaged. And yet in Japan, they've taken something that should have been considered damaged, and they've molded it back together with gold, making it quite beautiful. So in terms of being remarkable, I think what this quote speaks to is the fact that every single one of us is unique. We all come from our own backgrounds, our own cultures, and our own belief systems. But we have also all been broken in different ways, in whether it be by life, whether it be by experiences, whatever it may be. So in terms of that, I think it is really critical to always remember that you as an individual are unique in every way. And I think that it is critical to remember that your remarkability is so individualistic that none of us can take that away from you. Too often in life, we do not let our own voices come through. We land up allowing ourselves to feel that we should be either dictated to by those we work with, those we live with, those that influence us academically. And I'm here to say to you that your voices are unique and they should be heard. And what you should do to influence the co-creation of sustainable societies is to create unique frameworks, problem-probing ideas, and come up with solutions to everyday real-world problems. And if I were to speak on behalf and next to me of our distinguished Senate member today, is that we should all look towards being entrepreneurs. We should be focused on creating jobs rather than always being the ones to look for jobs. So that is something that is also really critical in influencing sustainable societies, because it is about empowering others and ourselves through entrepreneurial efforts. So in true Davinci style, I would like to, in terms of disruptive innovation, I'd like to innovate with a few quotes. So I hope the authors forgive me for messing around with their words. And it's the words of Nelson Mandela, Robin Sharma, Colin Powell, and Aristotle. And one of my favorite Mandela quotes says, "I have learned that courage was not the absence of fear, but the triumph over it. The brave man is not he who does not feel afraid, but he who conquers that fear." I think being an adult learner, few people understand that even if you are distinguished in your career and you're already a managerial leader, it is not easy taking on studies as an adult. We once again found ourselves questioning how we tell our own children, "You will study, you can do this," and we can't even tell ourselves that. So it is indeed a huge challenge. It is not only fear of failure, but also fear of the pressure that comes with having families, work commitments, and everything. Yet you still made it here today. And that shows me the type of grit, determination, and courage every single one of you have. I think that obstacles are always the cost of greatness. And so whenever we have greatness and find greatness within ourselves, we will have to overcome some kind of challenge or some kind of obstacle. And you have fallen, jumped, or whatever it took for you to get here, rolled, but you have gotten over every single obstacle to reach this pinnacle here today. I've always wondered if there's secrets to success. And I really think that this quote by Colin Powell says, "There are no secrets to success. It is the result of preparation, hard work, and learning from failure." I think what is so critical about this is that it shows that there's no miracles to success, because I think a lot of people just feel that it falls in someone's lap. But hard work and determination, perseverance, and all those characteristics that truly make us African, because that is how we have been raised as African children, is something that is quite remarkable in itself. And that is why I believe that we have the potential to be the most successful continent if we just had a little bit more faith in our skills that we have. Successful people are not actually gifted. They just work really hard, and then they succeed on purpose. Because excellence isn't really an accident. It is the result of high intention, sincere effort, intelligent direction, skillful execution, and the vision to see the obstacles as opportunities. I know these words are easier said than done. Believe me, I've also worked some hard roads. But the reality of it is that I think too often in life we see obstacles or challenges as a way to defeat us. And I really hope that in your lifelong learning journey, that you come to know when you struggle with challenges and you probe problems, the thing that's awesome about learning is that it shifts your reality and it shifts who you are. So even if it only changes you a little, it changes your perspective on things. And we hope as a Davincian that you've learned from an ecosystemic perspective to see things through multiple and variable lenses, and not just through a singular lens, but rather everything that makes up you, the beautiful, remarkable, multi-talented, multi-diverse individual, your personal identity, your professional identity, your religious, political, whatever other identity makes you who you are, your situational identity, we hope that that holistic person is who you always show up as to the world, because you are indeed remarkable. Thank you very much. I now have great pleasure in introducing you to our guest speaker. So there's nothing more wonderful for me than when the guest speaker aligns so well with the dream, the purpose, and everything to do with what is Davinci. And Dr. Ritz, who got her PhD from Davinci and is an alumnus of our institute, is certainly one of those people. I think if I had to read her entire CV, I might be here all day, and even her summarized CV is pretty impressive. But the part I find even more remarkable is when we offered Mary the opportunity to do a video, because it is the crack of dawn in Atlanta, Georgia, she said, no, the graduates deserve me face to face. I will get up and I want to greet each of them personally. And that just shows Dr. Ritz's character and the type of person that she is. But she certainly has a profile to be proud of. Dr. Ritz has been in the business of empowering, educating, and encouraging people to reach their maximum potential for over a decade. Her passion is to help people see the best in themselves, develop and harness their skills to effect positive change in their lives, their organizations, their communities, and their families. These skills vary from leadership to team development and customer management. She is really a customer engagement and management queen, that is for sure. Dr. Ritz is the owner and the founder of Almenta International, a training and consulting organization founded in 2008 in Johannesburg, South Africa. She moved to the US in January of 2014 when she re-established the same business model and company in the United States. She's a John Maxwell certified teacher, speaker, and coach. She holds an undergraduate degree in marketing from the Institute of Marketing Management. And in 2002, she graduated from High Point University in North Carolina with an MBA in international business. She holds a PhD from the Davinci Institute in the Management of Technology and Innovation, where she had her business focus on customer centricity. And she's a proud Davinci alumnus. Dr. Ritz is the author of Customer Centricity, Creating a Sense-Making Framework for Developing Economies. She believes that for businesses to remain profitable and relevant, the customer must be the focal point of their strategies. Hence her work in helping organizations become more customer-centric. However, when all is considered, it becomes apparent that people, things like teams and leadership, are responsible for driving towards customer centricity and business in general. Customer centricity, she says, can never work alone or in isolation, and its success is highly dependent on the team and leadership effectiveness. She is a true managerial leader in this sense, balancing between management and leadership. Consequently, Dr. Ritz has strategically adopted a holistic view by bringing the three human elements in the business mix: customer management, leadership development, and team development for business performance. As an international facilitator, speaker, and consultant, Dr. Ritz has had the privilege of working at an international level in North America and across Africa with small, medium, and large diverse organizations. She's worked with diverse companies, some of which include LG, P&G, Metropolitan Atlanta, Rapid Transit Authority, Anthem, Home Depot, Innovent, Econet, American Tire Distributor, among many others. The international and diverse experience sets her apart and informs her work and approach. Dr. Ritz has multiple areas of expertise, and being a John Maxwell speaker and teacher, she also facilitates John Maxwell's books and courses, a thought-provoking facilitator and consultant who uses innovative approaches that bring training and learning to life. Thus, she has successfully empowered people inside out, and she's a true Davincian. Dr. Ritz, thank you so much for joining us. We greatly appreciate it.
Thank you very much for having me. The program director, Senate members present today, the directors of the board, the principal and CEO, the executive management team, deans, faculty members present today, business people, members of society, friends and family, and most importantly, the distinguished guest, the graduation class of 2020. Good afternoon and good morning from Atlanta, Georgia, the United States. In every story, there is a hero. The catalyst for any story is that the hero wants something. Though the story may start with the hero in a place of contentment and tranquility, eventually they will grapple with internal, external, and even philosophical challenges. As the story progresses, these challenges will take the hero on a path towards discovering their desires, establishing a better future, and seeking an even deeper purpose and meaning of life. In direct alignment, the hero will also realize that they can't resolve difficulties on their own. They need a guide. However, it is important to note that the hero isn't looking for an ordinary guide, but a very specific one, a very particular one, one who invites them in and provides meaning and life-altering guidance. Class of 2020, you are the hero. So it's very possible that your life or career was peaceful and unflustered, but at some point, your world was disrupted and you faced new and increased challenges. These may have been career or organizational challenges, such as missed opportunities in promotion or difficulties with leaders, customers, or operational matters. The disruption may also have been internal frustrations, such as limiting beliefs, paradigms, and unmet desire for self-development and improvement. Whether the form of disruption was minor or significant, you soon realize that success was difficult to achieve alone, and you needed a particular guide, one who was willing to invite you in and take you onto your own journey of discovery and accomplishment. Class of 2020, Da Vinci has been the guide who provided direction to your internal, external, and philosophical challenges. Through the Mode 2 learning experience, you've been prepared and empowered with the necessary tools to not only solve your previous career, workplace, or interpersonal challenges, but identify and overcome new challenges from a systemic perspective, lead from the front, and co-create a new reality. Today, as each of you have successfully reached the end of this path, and the guide's work deemed complete, know that many others are cheering you on to be better and to be more. Class of 2020, it is important to know that your story will have a sequel and possibly several as your journey continues. So as we celebrate you today for achieving a great milestone, and as the guide is unleashing you into the world to be the disruptor and not disrupted, with your permission, let me also be your guide for the moment and provide guidance on how you can approach your coming sequels. You may be interested to know that I'm a proud alumnus from the Da Vinci Institute class of 2015. Like you, I was the hero and went on to achieve in my first cycle, or maybe that was my fifth cycle. My story could be very similar to yours. In my case, I was born and raised in Zimbabwe. After completing my high school diploma, I was unable to gain admittance into the one and only Zimbabwean university at the time, the University of Zimbabwe. Even on my second application to the same university, the system had declared that I wasn't good enough for higher education. You see, throughout junior and high school, I had been labeled not so academically talented by teachers and even family members. And now the University of Zimbabwe had just endorsed the same label. Can you imagine the disappointment? I'm also reminded of the manager I served as a personal assistant and how, after reviewing my resume, he pointedly remarked that I was uneducated and obviously not a degree holder. The not so academically talented label had become my identity. But to be honest and to be fair, there was some truth to it because I was not an A student. I would occasionally, and I mean occasionally, end that rare A. I was more of a C, at most a B plus student. However, as I advanced academically, my label became less meaningful and my grades continued to improve. It was purely through hard work, determination, and finding the right guidance from my professors that I graduated with a doctoral degree and with a student award. They had to sneak it in. So how does one rise from working as a personal assistant with no undergraduate qualification to holding a doctoral degree and owning an international business? I think you're curious. The simple but not so easy answer is that I'm a disruptor. I challenge the norm and the status quo. If well-defined systems don't make sense, I don't accept them, even if it means losing popularity for a while. I follow my own trajectory and I rally acolytes around that trajectory. I question and I remain curious. I disqualify personal labels and limiting beliefs. Above all, I have an 83-year-old father who continues to encourage me as he fights for his life every day amid health problems. And like you, class of 2020, I had a guide, the Da Vinci Institute, and specifically, Professor Benny Anderson. My first meeting with Professor Benny Anderson was to explore if the Institute would admit a student like me into their PhD program. The challenge I had faced with other local universities was that they would not accept a student into their doctoral programs who had not completed a research project at the master's level. To these universities, not having this was an indicator that I would not be able to manage the workload at a doctoral level. I fully expected Professor Benny Anderson to share the same concerns. But as you can imagine, I was more than pleasantly surprised when he said, and I quote, "I'm not concerned that you did not complete a thesis. I believe you can do the work." At that point, I knew I was in the right university with the right professor, the right guide. I was convinced that I had just met another disruptor who goes against the norm. I think we can all agree that Da Vinci's approach to education goes against how most academic systems operate. I'm sure we can agree. Now, let's fast track to 2018, when I committed to hosting a leadership conference in Harare, Zimbabwe, as a way of giving back to my own country. As I announced this plan to many people, most of them advised against the idea because the country's dire economic, political, and social system meltdown, it would be difficult to secure a wide audience. However, and I'm sure you guess it, because of my tendency to go against the norm, I made the decision to host the conference anyway. To my good fortune, it was Professor Benny who, without hesitation, without doubt, agreed to my request to travel to Zimbabwe and serve as a guest speaker. He believed it could be done. And I was so proud and honored that his participation helped make the conference a success. After today, each of your sequels will be a continuation of your story, but with different internal, external, and philosophical challenges that you will need to resolve on an ongoing basis. So, class of 2020, the heroes, I empower you with this in preparation for your sequels. Number one, reject labels for your identity, especially when you did not create them. Number two, challenge systems that try to define and limit you. Instead, choose to redefine and create new systems and realities. And number three, continue to question and push those boundaries. And number four, reflect on the following question, please. If something is working, does it mean that it doesn't need further challenging or questioning? Sit on that question. And finally, number five, if you need guidance and a roadmap for your next or third or fourth sequel, come back to Da Vinci, where you know you've got a great and ideal guide. Thank you. Congratulations. I'm Flope Makorokoto, the class of 2020, the heroes. You've been unleashed. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Ritz. I think we can all agree that we can see why she is indeed inspirational. But I think for me, I salute you for being the square peg in the round hole. I think far too often we allow ourselves to actually be boxed into something, told that we are not the clever child in the class, we're not the thin child, the pretty child, we're not this, we're not that, and we can never amount to anything. It is really sad when societal systems, whether it be at a school level, a community level, a peer level, break people to the point where somebody that has gone on to attain a PhD was told once that they were not academically minded. I think every single one of us has the potential to be academic, and our paths may differ, and the paths we take may differ, because for some, they will forge a path that is far more technical. For others, it will be far more classical academic, but none of those are paths that don't require knowledge. So I salute the square pegs in the round holes today. But also, I think it is critical that we see the world as something that is navigated by some. Because far too often, we actually do not have enough mentors and leaders. And every one of you sitting here today could potentially mentor and lead people. I think that that becomes a really critical aspect. Our Senate member who sits alongside me has been involved in incredible projects that we've co-created with Ezra around taking unemployed youths and working alongside government, Ezra's organization and DaVinci to actually create entrepreneurs out of people that currently do not have jobs and taking those students and reshaping them. But they need mentors. They come from backgrounds where they may need people who can show them, I came from the same place as you, and look where I got. And that's one of the things I certainly got out of your speech today, Dr. Ritz, is that you can always use a guide on your path. So perhaps now you need a guide at PhD level, but there are many students that are just starting their journey that could do with your depth and your experience to guide them in their next journey. The other thing is, I think that too often we label everybody. We are judgmental as a society. And I think it is critical that we see the beauty. I once read a really beautiful Kabbalistic principle, and I often do not, I seldom ever quote anything religious because I think it's quite personal. But it was something very interesting to me, and it spoke about people that have disabilities, physical disabilities. And the reading spoke about the fact that those souls do not require the same level of physical aesthetic beauty, so to speak, as we do, because their souls are of such purity and they have such depth and insight that they don't need the klipa, the earthly kind of covering that many of us have. And I often think what that actually meant, and it was very interesting to me, because it means that far too often we judge people on the way that they look, the way that they speak, where they come from, who they are, what money they have, how they were raised, all those aspects, what cars people drive. We label people with capitalistic social things that actually do not hold meaning, because some of the greatest leaders in the world have come out of some of the poorest communities and out of the poorest conditions, and they have fought above it because they are the round pegs in the square holes. Sorry, round the other way around. They are the square pegs in the round holes. I'm definitely one of those, clearly. And I think that it becomes critical because they are the people, as the quote says, that change the world. So Dr. Ritz, thank you very much for enlightening us. Thank you for joining us. Thank you for always flying the DaVinci flag high. I definitely think we should employ you for some marketing, because that was very unprompted, and I'm sure Prof. Anderson is, he's right here and he's cringing away. But thank you for being a square peg in a round hole. You are indeed remarkable. Thank you. It is now the exciting time of the proceedings when you get to come up and to receive your qualification today. And so what I will ask is that the academic procession will stand during the proceedings. I will request from our Honourable Senate member to grant permission to me to announce the candidate and for the registrar to confer the qualification. Once granted that permission, what we will then do is you will step forward. So as I said, you'll step towards me, give me your name, and then we will proceed from there. The photographer will take one photograph there and here. But before we begin, I would like to please ask that is Janine over there, Janine Wells. I would like to please call on Janine Wells from Metro Minds and thank in Metro Minds for the investments in the students that you've made, and ask that you please join us up here to congratulate the students. Unfortunately, due to COVID protocols, you will not be shaking the students' hands as you normally do. So today you will be bowed to, which is slightly different to normal. You can just stand alongside me there. Today you will be bowed to, and we thank you very much for joining us today and the investment that you continually make in students. Okay, no problem. Is she coming up now? Okay. Thank you very much. If the first student could please, sorry, the academic procession, just hold on a moment. I just need to confer the first moment. Honourable Member of Senate, I request to you to, I present to you the following candidates for the awarding of the qualification, higher certificate in management of technology and innovation, and I ask that you allow me to award these qualifications. Thank you very much. The first candidate may come forward. I think it'll just be easy if you guys step back a little bit, just because the candidates will stand in front. So if you just stand, you can, yeah, it's up to you if you want to stand between the, over there and there. Yeah, that's perfect. That is just in the middle. Thank you. Yes, that's fine. I hear you are on a flight. Okay, no problem. No problem. We understand completely. The first candidate I introduce to you is Mbali Happiness Tele. Congratulations. Mbali, we congratulate you on this remarkable achievement and all those that stood alongside you on this journey. Congratulations, Mbali. And have a safe flight back to Durban. Mbali is having to catch a flight, so she asked for some grace to go up first as she is late for her flight. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you our candidate, Tumelo Edward Joseph. Congratulations. You are more than welcome to shout, scream, ululate, do whatever you wish to celebrate alongside your colleagues and friends and classmates. Tumelo, we congratulate you on this remarkable achievement and we say well done to you. I present to you, Botumelo Matamela. Congratulations. Woo! Thank you that we've got some liveliness in here. Botumelo, if you can just face the camera over there. Botumelo, we congratulate you and all those that walked this path alongside you. Congratulations. We congratulate Mamodise Anne Ramatibela. Congratulations. Mamodise, we congratulate you on this remarkable achievement. Well done. Sonia? Yeah, if you can just wait, I would prefer to do one candidate at a time. Thanks. Thanks, Brett. I congratulate Brett Jason Stunder. Congratulations. I see you've got some audience excitement there, Brett. Congratulations, Brett, and all those that stood alongside you on this journey. I congratulate Sergey Kurt Nelson. Congratulations. Did I pronounce your name correctly?
Yes, perfect.
Okay. I always worry when I see the accent that it's wrong. Sergey, we congratulate you on this remarkable achievement and all those that stood alongside you in this journey. Congratulations. It gives me great pleasure to introduce to you Tabiso Dawn Nzimande. Congratulations. Tabiso, you are being instructed to take off your mask and to smile. Congratulations, Tabiso, on this remarkable achievement. Well done. We congratulate Nomandla Nkosi. Congratulations. Thank you that we've got some liveliness back there. Yay. Nomandla, we congratulate you on this remarkable achievement and all those that stood alongside you on your journey. Congratulations. You've got some friends in the audience there. Thanks, Sheldon. I introduce to you Sheldon Robert Banks. Congratulations. I think, Sheldon, you were ready to race on ahead without me. So Sheldon is definitely leading from the front, and Louise is now fixing your tassels. That was from your sprint. Congratulations, Sheldon, on this wonderful achievement, and we wish you much success into the future. As I explained, there are people who graduate in absentia if they can't join us for some or other reason, and at DaVinci we still do want to acknowledge their names and the work and the journey that they've worked. So the first person who will be acknowledged in absentia is Sumaya Buban. We wish her congratulations. Our second person is joining us via Zoom, as time has changed and shifted here, and that is, we congratulate Palesa Lucy Klakudi. Palesa, on behalf of the Institute, we congratulate you on this remarkable achievement as we celebrate here alongside you. Your fellow classmates are smiling and waving towards you. I hope you can see us all. And I don't know if you want to say something or comment, but you don't have to. You're welcome to just wave. Okay, you good? Thank you. Well, we congratulate you on your remarkable achievements, and you are missed here in presence. Congratulations. Lizanne, sorry that I made you wait. We congratulate in our midst Lizanne DeLange. Congratulations. Lizanne, we congratulate you for taking this journey, and we wish you all the success into the future. Thanks, Hayley. The next candidate I call on today to receive their qualification is Hayley Ann de Villiers. Congratulations. You are welcome to keep your mask on if you want, Hayley-Ann. It's up to you. The joys of the masks. Women get a sort of thing here which is just faded. Congratulations, Hayley-Ann, on this remarkable achievement. We congratulate you and all those that stood alongside you for the journey. The next candidate that I present to you is Chantal Findlay. Congratulations. Socially, it becomes a bit awkward without the handshakes, not quite sure what to do. That is why we are just slightly bowing to each of you. I suppose like the Queen, Chantal, that we will bow to you. So you are all the kings and queens today, royalty for sure. Congratulations, Chantal, on this achievement. Well done. They say we save the best till last. So, Jared, it is you that is our best today, and that is Jared Roland Fremont. Congratulations. Jared, we congratulate you on this achievement and all those that stood alongside you. Congratulations. So since you were a relatively quiet crowd, I'm going to challenge the academic procession to see how loudly they can cheer for you. And you must join along when I say to Tumelo, Bortomelo, Mamodise, Brett, Sergey, Mbali, Tabiso, Normandla, Sheldon, Sumaya, Palesa, Lizanne, Haley-Ann, Chantel, and Jared. Congratulations. You are Davincians. Well done and congratulations. We'd like to thank MetroMinds for the investment that you make in education in South Africa on a continual basis. It really shifts the way that we do things. So thank you very much to all of you at MetroMinds. Congratulations. Thanks so much. The panel may be seated, the academic procession. I keep calling them the panel. I was clearly doing too many doctoral reviews. I was in doctoral reviews before graduation. Apologies, registrar. It is an apology, Senate. It is the academic procession, council and Senate members. So one of our proud traditions at Davinci is that we always serenade our kings and queens, our royalties, our graduates, with the sounds of the opera. We get opera singers to come and serenade you. Unfortunately, due to COVID-19 protocols, we are not allowed to sing in a public place. So right outside in front of the building, we got the opera singers to record for you and to be able to still serenade you, albeit via a virtual platform. So you can sit back and enjoy the screens on the side and behind you that you will see them, but you're welcome to just listen along to God Bless Africa that we dedicate to each of you today. Agree, indeed beautiful. Before I call on our honourable Senate member to dissolve this congregation today, it is indeed my honour to be given the privilege to conclude today's ceremony on behalf of the Davinci Institute Senate, Council, Board and Executive to really wish you a hearty congratulations. When we speak about remarkability, we mean this when we say that we want to embrace diversity and we want to embrace diverse thinking. And that is why symbolically, if I could ask that the flag comes up, your family members at home will see it, and on the first page of your programs, it is also there. We don't do anything by chance here. Our symbols all have meaning. So what exactly do I mean by those dots and kites and flags and all those things that we've got all over the place at Davinci? The kite is a very specific analogy, and it was by actual chance that Dr. Ritz spoke about being navigating, because I didn't know what her speech was going to be on. Obviously, this is for the entire graduation series, and that is that you are the master of your own destiny. So you are that person at the bottom of the flag that is the kite that is able to hold onto that kite and navigate where it goes. There is no one else in control of your life except for you as an individual. The choices, the chances, the opportunities you take and miss are yours and yours alone. We are bound sometimes by fear because it can be hampering. But to harness your remarkability, you will have to find a way to stay rooted in your traditions, your cultures, your beliefs, and whatever grounds you. But you will have to give yourself the rite of passage to also fly free far beyond the clouds. One of my favorite poems about a kite says, "When the winds of adversity come, remember one thing. Kites fly the very highest against the wind. Kites don't fly in spite of opposition. Kites fly high because of opposition. In fact, they couldn't actually fly without opposition." If you think about it, kites do best in the hardest, toughest winds. So when the winds of change come your way, when the winds of challenge come your way, when the winds of adversity come your way, just know that your kite is well equipped to deal with all the challenges that you are facing, because you are in control of your life and your kite is flying against the strongest winds because you have the tools, you have the tenacity, you have the perseverance to do it. And yes, I don't deny that your kite might get a little bit tattered and torn at stages, but the beautiful thing about that is you can reel it back in, go back into the safe enclosure of your personal identity, your family identity, and you can find yourself again. Fix that kite, heal yourself, and get that kite right back in the sky again, because kites also don't have glass ceilings. They break through all barriers. None of you have a glass ceiling. Whatever you choose to do with your life, you have the opportunity to do that. The other thing about a kite is that I really feel that it's got this exuberance and this excitement about it when you see children flying a kite for the first time. It's this excitement that this thing that they're holding that looks like nothing really, and maybe in their minds a piece of paper, suddenly they let go of it, and if it's in August in South Africa and the winds blow, that kite takes flight and you see them looking up to the sky with such excitement. You are role models to society as educated people. You have the privilege of having an education that you now need to influence the co-creation of sustainable, authentic societies. Not ones where we hand things out at a robot to people, but ones where we actually probe problems and create solutions for people to be able to sustain themselves. The reason that the Davinci Institute cow is considered the purple cow is for two reasons. Yes, the first is quite individualistic, and it is from Seth Godin, the author, and it says that if you were driving along a path and you saw all these cows everywhere, and you saw the brown, the black, the spotted, whatever it was, they might be magnificent, beautiful Six Sigma cows. But if whilst you were driving, a purple cow were to step out of that herd, you would without doubt remark on it, possibly stop, jump out, take photos just to prove to people. But that is your individual way of being remarkable. Each of you in your workplaces, you are surrounded by people that also have qualifications, that are also educated, that are also managers, that might have 10 years experience the same as you. But what is it that makes you remarkable? And don't be ashamed to have your individual goals, because they are important. But the second symbolism of the Davinci cow comes from African tradition and culture. And that is, what is the sign of a cow, or what is the cow symbolic of in African tradition and culture? If you have multiple cows, I will be very motu here and say, I will ask you, what is the sign of a cow? What is the symbolism? Wealth. Okay, so that is exactly it. But it is not wealth for self, and that's what I want to say. Our symbolism of the African cow is Ubuntu, which is I am because we are. Not I am because I am. I am because we are. You are part of a community, and it is important that you celebrate your individual success and you do gain wealth for yourself. We want that for you. We want you and your family to enjoy in your successes. But at the same time, you have a responsibility to go out there and to create wealth for others, not by handing out, but by creating innovative ideas, solutions, frameworks, depending on what you do in your own careers, that will change the way other people are able to generate wealth, and success for themselves. If each one of us just helps one other person in society to generate their own wealth, can you imagine what a wonderful society we would live in and how much in the world poverty would be alleviated? Right now in pandemic times, we are faced with economic collapse. We are faced with people starving, and yet we do have corruption in society. So we need to be those people that go and change what is out there, utilizing the knowledge and skills that we have been given. So why then would I say that this kite has the nine dots and the colors and all of that? Those nine dots, for those of you that, I don't know if Prof. Ben did your introduction, I see nodding, and that means he told you when he gave you those nine dots to draw four straight lines and to connect the dots without lifting your pen. And when I did it, I thought I was brilliant, and I told Ben, and I wasn't a student, so I actually was already an employee, and I said, well, I did it, so I'm clearly brilliant. And he said, no, you have actually failed. And I was like, how could I have failed? I did the task. He said, yes, you connected the dots, but you never allowed your mind to think outside the box and to stretch beyond those lines and to not only connect the dots, but to collect the dots as well, the ones you don't see, the ones that are different to you, the ones that will be those innovative entrepreneurial ideas out there that will change the world. So I then realized that those dots, when you extend them, when you connect the dots and you only make with the four lines in the blocks, you only have maybe three or four options. I think some people have said nine options to get it to work. The moment you extend the dots and you don't pick up your pen, but you still connect them just a little bit more widely, suddenly there's 27, 100, 183 possibilities. If you make it three-dimensional, there are endless possibilities. So when we stretched our minds and dots, it created a kite. And that is why we speak now to the Da Vinci kite and what it creates and why we selected it for your graduation. Also, we think it is important. That box doesn't represent box thinking. It represents social constructs, our cultures, our political beliefs, our languages, our ideologies. Don't ever lose who you are. Embrace your faith. Embrace your spirituality. Embrace your diversity, your language, your culture, where you come from. Never forget that. It doesn't mean that you don't connect the dots if you collect them. So keep yourselves rooted and grounded in your connections, but go out there and collect the dots that aren't like you, that aren't the same as you, so that you can bring them back into your own communities with a collection of ideas that are diverse to your own. Because if we all think alike and think similarly, we will never have diverse thinkers in this world. So I implore you today to celebrate each other's diversity and your own. We're in dire need of peace in this world, and you are able to create educated peace, which means you can actually change the world. I congratulate you on your remarkable achievement today. Well done. It now gives me great pleasure to call upon our Honourable Senate Member to close and dissolve this congregation.
As the Member of the Senate of the Da Vinci Institute, I hereby dissolve this congregation of the Da Vinci Institute for Technology and Management.
Thank you. We always sing the national anthem of the Republic of South Africa. We are well aware that many of our facilitators, our students, our guest speakers, etc., come from many places, but our qualification is registered and accredited in South Africa, and our roots are here, even though we are a distance provider that provides multiple platforms in terms of education solutions. So we always honor South Africa by singing the national anthem. Today it will be listening to the national anthem. And the other part of it is, so what will happen is that afterwards the Da Vinci staff, some of our students and community, have created a video for you. So once the national anthem is played, you'll be able to look behind you or on the side of you to have a look at the video. They're playing the same things. Enjoy the video. You can sit, stand, dance, do whatever you want with the video. And after which, the academic procession will then leave to Guardiamas, and you will all be outside and able to, you can take pictures. I mean, today we've got our most handsome one. Sorry, Zane, no offense. I mean, you've already had your moment in the sun. We've got our most handsome Senate member, if I can say. So if you guys would like photos with the academic procession on your cell phones, our photographer will be there to take them. Email, your conveners will email you the pictures just to have a moment. And we will serve refreshments and drinks to you outside as well, to you and your family. We thank all of you that have joined us online. Please stay on for the national anthem and the video. And we wish you all well this afternoon. Please rise for the national anthem of South Africa, Nkosi Sikelela. To Tumelo, to Botumelo, to Mamodise, Brett, Sergey, Mbali, Tabiso, Nomandla, Sheldon, Sumaya, Palesa, Lizon, Haley Ann, Chantel, and Jared. Congratulations! Please remain standing while the academic procession leaves to Guardiamas and then join us outside.